Buying your first home is a big deal. It's not just about finding the perfect place, it's also about understanding all of the steps that you need to take before signing on that dotted line. Things like getting pre-approved for a mortgage and looking at homes in your price range, as well as making sure that properties are structurally sound and it will actually be a good home for you. And what actually happens when you sign on that dotted line? What is a closing? Well, in this video, I'll walk you through the steps from getting pre-approved for a mortgage all the way to what happens at closing so that you, as a first-time home buyer, can start looking for your first home. But first, if you want me to email you a free and current buyer's guide or seller's guide, leave your email in the comments with the word buyer or seller, and I'll be sure to send it over your way. Hi, I'm Peter Von Call with Pearson Smith Realty, and I help people buy and sell homes with confidence so that they can have a stress-free transaction. I know that buying or selling a home tends to be a stressful situation, but I believe that the more educated and equipped you are on the front end of a transaction, the more confident you can be through closing a transaction. All right, so how do you buy your first home? Well, the first step is to get pre-approved for a mortgage. Getting pre-approved for a mortgage is possibly the most important step in buying your first house because you need money to buy things and the mortgage will let you buy your first home. So you'll find a mortgage lender who will look at your financial information like your credit score, your income, your debt to income ratio, down payment amount, and then they'll figure out how much money they'll loan to you so that you can put it towards a house. This is beneficial to you because it helps narrow down the list of homes based on what you're able to afford. There are plenty of lenders out there, and you want to make sure that you're finding the best one for you and your needs. Some lenders will have lower interest rates for you, while some other lenders may offer a lower loan origination fee or something else. So I typically recommend that you apply with 3 different lenders and see what sort of loan and what kind of mortgage works best for you. Once you're pre-approved, you can start looking at houses, and you'll need a real estate agent to show them to you or at least let you inside. So a real estate agent really makes the process of finding a home easier. They'll send you listings in your price range that meet all your needs and walk with you through each property so that you know what to expect before buying it. Another benefit is that your agent can see homes that are coming soon that haven't even hit the market yet, and they'll send them to you, and if you like it, you can be first in line to see them. Sometimes they may even be able to work it out with the sellers and the listing agents so that they can write you a pre-market offer if you find something you really love, to make sure that nobody else gets it. A good real estate agent can also provide you with comps. These are important, and sometimes sellers will ask for too much based off what comparable homes are going for in the area. Your agent will help you write an offer and help craft it in a way that probably gives you some advantages, and also can guide you on what's a strong offer, what's a weak offer, help you out in all that. And remember that a good real estate agent has your best interest at heart, and they have the experience and the knowledge to help you get your dream home. If you have any questions or hesitations, just ask them. All right, so next, you have an agent, you've been pre-approved. Next, you want to look at homes in your price range and make sure that they're in good shape. Owning a house is a big investment, and so be sure that you can actually afford the investment that you're making. Just because you're pre-approved for a loan that will get you a $500,000 house doesn't mean that you need to go out and get a $500,000 house. Because with home ownership comes various costs. A good and common rule people follow, and I recommend, is to not spend more than 28% of your monthly income on your mortgage. This is important because oftentimes a home will look great on the outside, but when you go inside, it's not as good as you may have thought. Curb appeal is a real thing, and buyers are often swayed by what they see on the exterior of the property and end up overlooking issues that will leave them frustrated with the property later. If you put in an offer on a house, make it contingent on a home inspection and get one as soon as possible. You want that home inspection because that will tell you everything that you need to know about a house and give you a great idea at what you're getting. If there's something wrong with a house, a home inspection will make you aware of the issue, and the contingency will allow you to walk away if you need to. Now, maybe there is a small issue like mold in the attic and you're not sure if it's worth walking away over, but will definitely need some attention or updates. If this is the case, then ask around and see how much it may cost to fix it. In fact, you probably know someone, a homeowner, who had to fix a similar issue in their house, so you can ask them. They might be able to recommend how to go about it, give an idea of how much it'll cost them, maybe even give you the name of the person who fixed it for them. Another person to ask, your real estate agent. Remember, they're in your corner and they want to see you in your dream house as much as you want to be in your dream house. They know people who have been in your shoes before, and they can recommend probably a few contractors that can give you a few quotes for repairs or at least lead you in a general direction of how much it may cost to fix. And remember, it's typically okay to walk away if you have a home inspection contingency, and if there's an issue and you can't afford to fix it or something that needs fixing puts you in an uncomfortable situation financially, there are plenty of homes out there. If it's perfect, but there's a wall falling down, it's probably worth walking away over. So that brings us to other costs. What are closing costs for the buyers? So there isn't really a set fee. Closing costs vary from location to location and transaction to transaction. There isn't really one set price, but as the buyer, you should have an idea of how much money you're willing to spend on everything that needs to be done when closing on a home. Every transaction is different, but you should expect some additional fees before the transaction is closed. So, what can you expect to pay for? Well, you have the mortgage origination fee, which is typically somewhere around 1% of the total loan. Figure out how much that is when you get pre-approved, and remember, shop around with different lenders to find the best deal for you. Some people might offer lower than 1%, higher than 1%. Figure it out. You also have fees for various inspections. There's the home inspection fee, which could be around $400, $500. Again, that varies depending on where you are, what company you go with, but you have to pay for it if you get a home inspection. And remember, you should. Your lender will want an appraisal for the home, which will cost you some money that you'll also have to pay. You may also have to receive a radon inspection, a wood destroying insect inspection, which is only like $40, but a lot of these little things can add up. There's fees for mortgage insurance, title insurance, a premium for home insurance, fees based on prorated taxes depending on when you might move into the home, and there might be a tax for when the property is transferred from one owner to owner. You have to pay the title company. It adds up. The point is that there are a lot of small costs that you'll have to pay as the buyer that can really add up. So how can you get around these closing costs? Typically you can't, but if a house has been sitting on the market for a little while, you could ask the sellers in your offer to cover some or all of the closing costs in the transaction. It really depends on the timing of the market and your area, and the seller can always say no and reject that offer, but the answer is always no if you don't ask. So if you find a house that's been sitting, ask them to cover closing costs. So what actually happens at closing besides paying a lot of fees? Well, a lot actually, and it's the final step in buying a home. This is when all the legal papers will be signed, and you'll be signing a lot of papers. It's things like the mortgage note saying that you promised to repay the loan, and a mortgage or a deed of trust securing the note, and a settlement statement, and then the title company will hand you a huge stack of papers, and so that they can put the deed to the home in your name, and you'll give them a certified check for the amount due to cover the down payment and the additional closing costs. And then they'll hand you the keys and you're a homeowner. Congratulations. See, the process of buying a home is complicated and it requires a lot of different moving parts to be in place. And if you're thinking about taking the leap into home ownership, it's important to know exactly what you need to do beforehand so that there are no surprises when you're closing on your new house. And if you're in the Northern Virginia area, I'd be happy to talk with you about any real estate needs that you may have. My name is Peter Von Kahl. I'm with the Property Vine team at Pearson Smith Realty, and you can get in touch with me by emailing me at p.vonkahl@pearsonsmithrealty.com. Have a good day.